Let's begin reading here in Acts chapter 9 at verse 10. I'll read verses 10 through 19, and we'll get into our study this evening. Acts chapter 9, beginning at verse 10, reading to verse 19. Now there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias, and to him the Lord said in a vision, "Ananias." And he said, "Here I am, Lord." So the Lord said to him, "Arise and go to the street called Straight, and inquire at the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus, for behold, he is praying. And in a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him, so that he might receive his sight." Then Ananias answered, and he said, "Lord, I've heard from many about this man, how much harm he has done to your saints in Jerusalem, and here he has authority from the chief priests to bind all who call on your name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, for he is a chosen vessel of mine to bear my name before Gentiles, kings, and the children of Israel, for I will show him how many things he must suffer for my name's sake." Ananias went his way and entered the house, and laying his hands on him, he said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road as you came, has sent me that you may receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." Immediately there fell from his eyes something like scales, and he received his sight at once, and he arose and was baptized. And when he had received food, he was strengthened. Then Saul spent some days with the disciples at Damascus. We've been looking at the amazing, miraculous conversion of Saul of Tarsus, a man who hated Christians and Christianity with such a deep passion that he actually literally was breathing out threatenings towards those who were followers of Christ. And as we have looked at his transformation, we've seen how God has such a powerful way of reaching into people's lives and transforming him. This man hated believers. He considered them blasphemous and deserving of punishment. And he also considered it his holy duty to find them wherever they were and to bring them back to Jerusalem in order that they might stand trial. Now, in Acts 22, he's sharing about his attitude and all concerning this. And he says in Acts 22, 4 and 5, "I persecuted this way to the death, binding and delivering into prisons both men and women, as also the high priest bears me witness, and all the council of the elders, from whom I also received letters to the brethren, and went to Damascus to bring in chains even those who were there in Jerusalem to be punished." That was his testimony. In chapter 26 of Acts, verse 11, he said, "I punished them often in every synagogue, compelled them to blaspheme, and being exceedingly enraged against them, I persecuted them even to foreign cities." He wasn't content to try and rid them from the city of Jerusalem. This was a man who obtained letters of authority to go all the way into Damascus, Syria, and any that he would find along the way to take, put in chains, bring back, and try as heretics. As he was on his way to Damascus, Syria, Jesus had appeared to him. And while he, Saul, was on his way to arrest believers, Jesus arrested him. And Jesus spoke to him. We saw it in verse 4 how he had said, "Saul, why are you persecuting me?" Now, Saul had been denying everything about Jesus. He had been saying things of Jesus, his teachings and all, and he was saying that they're incorrect, but he especially would have rejected his resurrection. And now the resurrected one is manifesting himself to Saul. He's letting him see who he is. You know, when you read the book of Revelation in chapter 1, it says at verse 8, the Lord speaking, Jesus speaking, he says, "I am he who lives and was dead. Behold, I am alive forevermore." And so Saul was denying that Jesus Christ was the resurrected one, and yet the one who he's denying, the one who's compelling others to blaspheme concerning, this is the one who appears to him on the road to Damascus and lets him know beyond a shadow of a doubt that he's alive and that the preaching of the cross and the resurrection is absolutely true. And as he's speaking to him, he's saying, why are you persecuting me? You see, in persecuting mine, in persecuting my people, you are actually persecuting me. How do I put that in a way that we all understand? I think we all could understand that, most likely do understand that. But as I think about this, it's kind of like this. If you love one of my children, if you were to approach me and say, you know, I really love your son. I love your daughter. I love your grandbabies. If you said that to me, you're loving me. You're loving me because I love them. And that to me is a very important thing, for you to care about my kids. And if somebody says, you know what, I just love your children, that touches my heart. But if someone does wrong to them, it's just not that they're doing wrong to them, they're doing harm to me because they're mine. And when Jesus is speaking to Saul, why are you persecuting me? Who are you, Lord, that I'm persecuting? I'm Jesus. And when you persecute one of those who belong to me, Saul, don't you understand? You're persecuting me. You're persecuting me. It's not me, in other words, alone that you're rejecting, Saul. In reality, you are rejecting me. In John 15:18, Jesus said, if the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. And so the hatred that was being, that was rushing out towards believers was not simply directed to the people themselves, but Jesus said, no, in reality, you're rejecting me. You're not just rejecting them. You're rejecting me along with them. As a matter of fact, you're really rejecting me. And so when this happened, Paul would later on use this in his ministry to share concerning his credentials in ministry. You see, seeing the risen Christ was a requirement to be an apostle. Remember in chapter 1 here in the book of Acts how we saw in verses 21 and 22, therefore of these men who have accompanied us all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John to that day when he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection. And so that was one of the credentials of the Apostle Paul, because when he was writing to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 1, he said this, he said, am I not free? Am I not an apostle? Have I not seen Jesus our Lord? In 1 Corinthians 15:8, it reads, last of all, he appeared to me also. This is one of the ways of validating whether a person was really an apostle. Just this week, I had a conversation with someone who was saying to me that they had been in conversation with someone who was saying to them that the church they go to is pastored by an apostle. And I said, really? And I said, you know, many people are using that term today. They're calling it apostolic ministry. I said, but they're not reading their Bibles. Because one of the validations or the credentials that an individual you would utilize in reference to an apostolic call was that they were eyewitnesses of the risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. They also were used to write scripture. And so an individual who's calling himself an apostle is incorrect. He's not an apostle. What he is a false prophet, but that's something else. No, I'm just teasing you. Someone's writing that down. They're just using it. They're utilizing a position that's improper. There are no apostles today, not in the biblical sense. Now, Jesus had, in an unmistakable way, hunted down Saul, and he caught him. He revealed himself to Saul. Saul was converted to faith in him. A man who was breathing out threatenings. A man, and we're going to see this in a moment, who with all of his strength and all of his will, with all of everything within him, and this to me is really important, I want to lay this down for you. A man who was willing to go anywhere to persecute believers became a man who was willing to go anywhere to make believers. What an amazing conversion. And you say within yourself, does that happen to this day? And the answer is yes, of course it does. Maybe not in the magnitude of a Saul. Let's face it, there was one Saul. But at the same time, does God still do that? Absolutely. Just this last week, I had asked you last week if you would please remember, some of you perhaps did, Could you remember us in prayer? We're having a Calvary Chapel Pastors Conference. We just finished it. It just concluded today. So Monday, Tuesday, and into today, into Wednesday of this week, we had a Calvary Chapel Pastors Conference. And I'm part of a council. I'm part of the leadership over the entire Calvary Chapels throughout the world. And I have several friends who are part of what is called the Calvary Chapel Association Council. And several of us were on a platform answering questions for pastors and leaders in the Calvary Chapel movement. And as I was seated there on this panel, we're just sitting in chairs and all and answering questions, I'm looking across at Raul Reese. You want to talk about somebody breathing out threatenings. And everybody who knows Raul knows his testimony. Amazing testimony of the grace of God. An amazing testimony. Violent man. A man who wanted to kill his own wife and children. It's well documented. An amazing transformation from a man who hated to a man who is, he can't even speak anymore without tearing up about, he's very tender. God has done, and I'm watching him. And I'm thinking, look what God has done. And there's Jeff Johnson. Jeff Johnson's a pastor of Calvary Chapel in Downey. Jeff Johnson was a crazy man, loved his dropping acid, loved taking acid. He would run naked in the jungles of Hawaii, you know, loaded on acid. He still does that in church. That's a different story. There's Jeff, you know, and Mike McIntosh is seated next to me. This is a man who was so wild with acid. He just loved acid. And he would drop megatabs. He was always loaded. Somebody approached him, and he was in a desert. And the guy had a 45 and put it next to his head while he was loaded on acid and pulled the trigger. If you've heard the sound of a 45, that's a loud, loud weapon. And he thought his head had been blown off. He thought half of his head, he literally, because he was loaded on acid, believed that half of his head had been blown off, and it was just some freak miracle that he was able to continue to function in some ways. And he went to Calvary Chapel of Costa Mesa for prayer. And he walked up to Pastor Chuck, and there was a couple of other men there, elders in the church, and he approached Chuck Smith, and he said, Chuck, could you pray for me? I only have half a head. And Chuck's looking at him thinking, no, I think it's all gone. No, he's... And Pastor prayed for him. And McIntosh became one of the most magnificent evangelists to this day, still traveling the world for Jesus Christ. And as I'm sitting in this panel, I'm looking at crazy men and I'm looking who got right with God. I'm looking at men that I was speaking to during the conference, gangsters, guys who spent years in prison, guys who were violent in every way, drug runners, people that if you knew their testimony, you wouldn't even sit next to him in church, let alone listen to him preach the gospel. And that's what God does with the gospel. He transforms lives. There's no other way for it to happen. That's what happens. That's what happens when Jesus arrests you. That's what happens. You turn around 180 degrees. You were going in this direction, but he rescues you, turns you around. You still retain your personality. You still retain the zeal and things. I mean, the man who was breathing out threatenings against those who believed in Jesus became the man who was breathing out the grace of God towards those who were yet to know him. He still has that power. He still had that power in his personality to go out and to debate when necessary and to speak when necessary and to give up his life, which he ultimately did when it was necessary. God still does this, by the way. That's why the whole theme of our conference this week, the last 3 days, has been stay true to the Word of God. Stay true to the Word of God. It is the power of God unto salvation to all who believe. There's no way to talk somebody into being a better person. You cannot talk me into loving the unlovely, but God can through His Word. God can show me what love is. God can evidence His love towards me. God can pour His Holy Spirit in my life, and God can transform me from being a hater into somebody who loves other people, because that's what the gospel of Jesus Christ does. And that's what He did in the life of Saul of Tarsus, a man who hated, a man you wouldn't want to be in the same room with, because he would have taken you, put you in chains, taken you to Jerusalem, witnessed against you to die, and gloried in it, thinking he did God service. When he said, "Who are you, Lord?" the Lord said, "I'm Jesus, and I'm the one you're persecuting. And it's hard for you to kick against the goads." The goads, when you look at an animal, we'll say a donkey or an ox that's pulling a cart, the goads were those sharp sticks that were on that cart, on a wagon, and it was intended to keep that beast from backing up. You're fighting against what I'm doing. You're kicking against those goads. And so when they speak, we saw this already, but we'll move into verse 10 in a second. Remember in verse 6, he was trembling, he was astonished, and then he asked that question, "What do you want me to do?" "Who are you?" is what he first said. Then he said, "What do you want me to do?" And I pointed out that his surrender was complete. He submitted. And so the Lord gave him a command. He said, "Rise, go into the city. You'll be told what you must do." What should I do? Go to the city. You will be told. So in verse 10, there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias. And to him the Lord said in a vision, "Ananias." And he said, "Here I am, Lord." You see, the Lord had done a work in Saul. In that time of blindness and fasting, he wanted to know, what am I to do about the Lord Jesus Christ? And in that time of going through a personal thing, he was struck blind. And even as it says in verse 9, he was 3 days without sight. He neither ate nor he drank. And so he's going through this time of blindness, and that would lead to a sense of isolation, that would lead you to a place of introspection. And he'd be wondering, what is it that I've gone through and what's going on? So he's rethinking, if you will, how he felt about Jesus. And this must have been a shocking experience for him. The one who was expecting to enter into Damascus kind of as a powerful and fearsome individual, being led by the hand and now placed in isolation, if you will, blind and considering what is going on. It says in 1 Timothy, he said this concerning himself in 1 Timothy 1:13 through 15, "Even though I was once a blasphemer and a persecutor and a violent man, I was shown mercy because I acted in ignorance and unbelief. The grace of our Lord was poured out on me abundantly, along with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Here is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst." That's what he came to realize. He came to save sinners. I am the chief. Broken in the way that he was, God crushed Saul. And as a result, he arose from the ashes, a great man of God. One of my favorite writers, and if you pick up his material and listen to what he says, it has a very prophetic ring to it, A.W. Tozer. One of my favorite writers, probably my favorite writer, I have to be honest with you. I like Tozer very much. A man who never had a very large church at all. A man that if you listen to him, they have tapes. You can actually go to Tozer Library and you can listen to him preach. And if you're insomniac, you'll go to sleep. I mean, he's very, very monotone. Bottom line, very monotone, prophetic. And A.W. Tozer said this, and I love this quote. "It is doubtful whether God can bless a man greatly until he has hurt him deeply." That's meat. I just gave you some meat. That's deep. How can God use a man greatly? He must first hurt him deeply. Absolutely. There's no doubt about that. He removes from you everything you trust in until all you have to trust in is him. And when that happens, now you become a mature saint in the things of the Lord. As long as you're relying on other things, you're not relying on him. And the Lord has a way of taking from us those things that matter so much to replace them with the things that matter the most. Keep that in mind. And that's what happened with Saul. He thought he was doing the right thing. And the Lord said, no, you're persecuting me. You're doing the wrong thing. And so he goes to Damascus. And there a man named Ananias is. Now we know that Ananias is a genuine follower of Jesus who is living in Damascus. Now, I'll very briefly say this. This is not the same Ananias we already saw in chapter 5, of course. This Ananias is in Damascus and is a devoted follower of God who had come to faith in Jesus Christ. Again, in the book of Acts, Paul mentions this in chapter 22, verse 12, where he said, a man named Ananias came to see me. He was a devout observer of the law, highly respected by all the Jews living there. So he's spoken of, Ananias is spoken of as a highly devoted and greatly respected man. The gospel has its greatest impact when it is given by those who live it. Keep that in mind. That's a very basic thing, isn't it? There are so many who are turned away from the gospel, not because of the message, but because of the messenger. The person who is giving the gospel isn't living the gospel. And the world can see hypocrisy. And the world responds to hypocrisy. It's one of the most odious odors in a person's nostril, hypocrisy. Who likes to be around it? And yet when somebody said, oh, you need Jesus, and yet they don't live as if they do, why would I listen to you? What do you have to offer me? And if it's so important, why aren't you living it? You really ought to live it before you give it, that kind of thing. Now, that, of course, is not to say you have to be perfect to be a preacher. Of course not. There's nobody perfect who's preaching except for me. You know that. No. No, I'm not saying that. I do not believe, nor do I teach in sinless perfectionism. Of course not. We're all sinners in need of the grace of God. Every one of us, every moment of our life. Not one of us is better than the next. Of course not. We all sin and fall short of the grace of God. But at the same time, you live appropriately. You live worthy of the gospel of Jesus. You preach a gospel of transformation you first partake in. So you share and you live for Jesus. Ananias was one of those men that was highly respected. Highly respected, and thus he was used by the Lord in a mighty way. You see, his spotless life made the gospel believable, if you will. Now, I want you to notice something here. This, to me, is very enlightening. You see, again, in verse 10, the Lord said in a vision, Ananias. Now, what would you do if in the middle, you're sleeping, and all of a sudden you hear your name called? You know, would you look around saying, who is that? This is interesting. If it doesn't sound like my wife, just Marie and I live in that house. If it doesn't sound like Marie, I'm probably going to get scared. I'm probably going to say, honey, there's somebody calling you. Go and see who it is. That shows to us familiarity. He recognizes the voice. He recognizes the voice. Remember when young Samuel was there with Eli and how the Lord spoke, Samuel, and Samuel kept getting up and walking to Eli, the priest, and saying, you called? I didn't call you. Go back to bed. Goes back. Samuel gets up. Did you call me? I didn't call you. Go back to bed. Then he does it again. That's the Lord speaking to you. Listen. And so that's not the case here. When the Lord speaks to Ananias, responds immediately, "Here I am, Lord." What's that tell us? That tells us that he is familiar with that voice. That's what it tells us. Not only that, but it also shows to us he's obedient. This is what is really demonstrating that he's a genuine follower. Remember John 10:27, where Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." So the Lord is speaking. Now notice again in verse 10, he speaks to him in what is called a vision. What is a vision? Well, a vision has been defined as what we would call today a waking dream. It's a waking dream in which God gives a revelation, an insight, or spiritual direction. You see that in the Old Testament. Genesis 15:1, give you a couple of examples of this. Genesis 15:1, after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abraham in a vision, saying, "Fear not, Abram, I'm your shield, your exceeding great reward." Or Numbers 12, verse 6, he said, "Hear now my words. If there is a prophet among you, I, the Lord, will make myself known to him in a vision. I will speak to him in a dream." So the Lord would use that methodology in the Old as well as in the introduction of the New Testament. Obviously, today, seeing that we have the Bible, anything that is of such an experience will always be tested by the Word of God. And so just keep that in mind. In this particular case, Ananias has fellowship with the Lord. He recognizes his voice and speaks to him, "Here I am, Lord." Verse 11, the Lord said to him, "Arise and go to the street called Straight and inquire at the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus. For behold, he is praying. And in a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him so that he might receive his sight." And so he makes it clear that this is a man that he ought not to be afraid of, because notice what he says, "Behold, he is praying." That gives us insight, by the way, into what Saul has been doing for the last 3 days. Now, somebody said, undoubtedly, he was confessing his sin and coming to understand God's grace, because this shocking experience would be meditated upon, and even later on would speak concerning how God showed him this mercy. In verse 12, it says, in a vision, he has seen a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him. So that to us gives to us insight into a couple of things, and one would be the tenderness that was shown towards Saul. He had been given a hope for healing, and the Lord was speaking that to him. He's going to come in, and he's going to lay hands on you, Saul. This is how you know this is the one that I've sent to you. In Psalm 118, verses 18 through 21, listen to what the psalmist said. "The Lord has chastened me severely, but he has not given me over to death. Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord, through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks, for you answered me. You have become my salvation." And so he's going to enter in and lay hands on you. Now, as this is taking place, notice of verse 13, Ananias answered, "Lord, I've heard from many about this man, how much harm he's done to your saints in Jerusalem. Here he has authority from the chief priest to bind all who call on your name." In other words, you know, you're busy, Lord, running the universe, and you may not be up on current events. You don't seem to realize that this is a dangerous man. You don't seem to understand that if I go in and attempt to lay hands on him, that he more than likely will lay hands on me. And the way you want me to lay hands on him is not the way he's going to lay hands on me. Thus, I need to give you an update. You know, you probably haven't used Google yet concerning this man. He's a monster. You know, have you ever tried to instruct the Lord concerning what he directs you to do? Have you ever tried to inform him? I have. I think that's probably one of my habits in prayer, is to try and explain to him the situation in order that he might see my way as the best way. Just empower me as I do it, and it'll be cool. You know, that's what's going on with this man here. I just need to inform you concerning him. He's a very dangerous man. And by the way, the danger that this man poses is a danger I'm concerned about for my own life, for my own welfare. And thus, perhaps you want to rethink this commissioning and maybe send somebody else. But no, the Lord has better plans than that. You see, Ananias, as he's questioning the Lord, is basically saying, you know, this could be suicide. And not only that, but all ministry, my ministry in particular, could stop. Because when we read in chapter 8 of Acts, verse 3, it had said, Saul made havoc of the church, entering every house, dragging off men and women coming, committing them to prison. And so this is a dangerous man. So what does the Lord say? You know, thanks for letting me know. I truly appreciate it. No, verse 15, the Lord said to him, go, for he is a chosen vessel of mine to bear my name before Gentiles, kings, and the children of Israel. Notice verse 16, for I will show him how many things he must suffer for my name's sake. He's a chosen vessel of mine. You see, notice in verse 15, the Lord said to him, go. God's call is not up to men. God's call is God's call. He chose Saul and did not ask Ananias for input. God made the choice. He said, no, this is a chosen vessel of mine. Ananias is thinking, there are so many others. Why this man? But God has his ways, doesn't he? God has his plans. Again, at the pastor's conference just this week, talking to some of the men. And I love to hear other pastors as they think out loud about the grace of God in their life. And all of us have the same kind of testimony, almost all of us, which is, wow, look what God has done. Look what God has done. For so many years, I taught Bible studies to 3 people, 4 people. If we had 5 or 6 in the room, I was rejoicing. It's packed. I'm serious. It's packed. Look at that. Every chair is taken. We only have 3 chairs, but every chair is taken. I think the first Bible study that my wife Marie, who was not yet my girlfriend, came to, maybe the front room may have been 8 by 8 by 10, maybe. There may have been 6 or 7 people there. And you didn't listen, did you? And I was blessed. Because you never go into ministry for numbers. You never do. You go into ministry because there's nothing else you could do or would ever want to do. Telling people about Jesus, right? That's how it works. Ananias is thinking, no, there are so many others out there. Let me inform you concerning how bad this man is. And the Lord says, no, we're not debating this. The call isn't yours, Ananias. It's mine. So you go and you do what I'm telling you to do. For this man is a chosen vessel of mine. And by the way, you're concerned about how he has harmed others. Let me share with you that part of what's going to happen in his life is he will suffer greatly. He will be broken and he will be used mightily. He will be broken at my hand. So you pray for him that he might go out and do what God has called him to do. Again, God's call is not up to men. It's up to God. When Paul was writing in the book of Galatians in the introduction, in chapter 1, the very first verse, this is what he wrote. Paul, an apostle, sent not from men, nor by man, but by Jesus Christ and God the Father, who raised him from the dead. He knew his calling was from God and not from man. He had said in verse 16, I will show him how many things he must suffer for my name's sake. Somebody wrote, he would not merely profess repentance, but would manifest the sincerity of it by encountering trials and reproaches for his sake. You see, the New Testament chronicles so many of his sufferings. Paul writes concerning this in 2 Corinthians in chapter 11, verses 24 through 27. Listen to some of what he went through as he was writing. In 2 Corinthians, which is my favorite New Testament book outside of the Gospels, in 2 Corinthians, Paul is attacked by detractors, and no less than 21 times, when you read through 2 Corinthians in 13 chapters, you will find him actually explaining himself because he's been accused of certain things, no less than 21 times. And so Paul, when he writes it, it is his most open-hearted book. You can almost see that he wrote this book with his tears. You know, one of his, and I'm not quoting this one right now, but in the 12th chapter, he says, the more I love you, the less I'm loved by you. That's a brokenhearted pastor. He had told the Corinthians earlier in chapter 4 of 1 Corinthians, though you may have 10,000 instructors, yet you have but one father. I begot you in the gospel. I love you like a father loves a child, is what he was saying. And what is my thanks from you? You welcome in false teachers. You welcome in error. It's destroying you. He says, you want to talk about the super apostles who are boasting against me? You see, what they did is they made comparison. They said, you're listening to Paul? Have you even looked at him? Because he actually has to defend his looks. His words are weighty, but his bodily presence is weak. He's nothing. He doesn't speak well, they said. He doesn't speak well at all. He's not a trained orator. He's not entertaining. Don't you remember Eutychus? You'll see Eutychus here in the book of Acts. That when Paul was speaking, Eutychus fell asleep and fell out of a window and died. He bores you literally to death. What right does he have to minister to you? That's what they were saying. Read 2 Corinthians. Read and you will see him bleed through the pages of that book. You have to know what to look for, because what he's saying, very often he'll say, well, they're basically saying that I preach for a profit, that I'm really not worth, that I change my mind easily. You'll see him as he's weaving that in. It's actually an apologetic against accusations. And at one point, when they were saying that he really isn't worthy of anything or respect, he said, really? Well, in 2 Corinthians 11, 24 through 27, let me explain to you what I've gone through. This is what he says. Let me remove the veil so that you can see a little clearer into what takes place in my life, is what Paul was saying. 5 times I received from the Jews 40 lashes minus 1. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. I spent a night and a day in the open sea. I've been constantly on the move. I've been in danger from rivers, in danger from bandits, in danger from my own countrymen, in danger from Gentiles, in danger in the city, in danger in the country, in danger at sea, in danger from false brothers. I've labored and toiled and have often gone without sleep. I've known hunger and thirst and have often gone without food. I have been cold and I have been naked. Do you want to talk about their credentials? Put them next to me and see which one is the real one. You don't like the way I look and you don't like the way I teach. You've forgotten who begot you in the gospel. Have you outgrown your instructor? Are you that wise? He says, oh, I don't take money from you, but you gladly allow them to rob you. You see, sometimes you'll hear me, sometimes, I used to do it a lot quicker in the past. When I say, watch out for this guy, he's saying, send me money so I can send you this. They're robbing you. And then people get mad at me if I even mention a dollar in church. Oh, those preachers are always looking for money. Oh, please stop it. I remember somebody saying I make a profit from the bookstore. I don't. But they say that because people do that, because people find things fault to destroy. That's just a fact. You know, sheep are not scary. If I were walking through a dark alley and a sheep came out, meh, I wouldn't like, whoa. I'm in terror. I said, oh, it's just a sheep, right? But they do have teeth. And they do like to bite. And they do. And so Paul had to deal with that. But that was part of what he went through. He will suffer, it says here, he must suffer for my name's sake. And he speaks concerning that. He said in 2 Timothy 3:12, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. So as the Lord is speaking to him in verse 17 and all, Ananias went his way and entered the house, laying his hands on him. He said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus who appeared to you on the road as you came has sent me that you may receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately there fell from his eyes something like scales, and he received his sight at once. And he arose and was baptized, and when he had received food, he was strengthened. Then Saul spent some days with the disciples at Damascus. So, not only is he bringing healing to him, which we see take place, he is also bringing a commission. In Acts 22, verses 14 and 15, he said, "The God of our fathers has chosen you to know his will, and to see the righteous one, and to hear words from his mouth. You will be his witness to all men of what you have seen and heard." So, this is a man who's being commissioned. Now, I want to point something out. To be commissioned, he was first converted. Now, Ananias brought healing, and he brought the filling of the Spirit to Saul. We know that Saul has already been convicted. We already know that. And John 16:8 says that the Holy Spirit convicts man of sin, righteousness, and judgment. He's already been convicted. He's already been converted. How do we know that? Because Ananias speaks to him as Brother Saul. He would not have referred to him as Brother Saul, as a brother in the Lord, if he wasn't saved. So we know he's been convicted. We know he's been converted. As a believer, he has been indwelt by the Spirit, because Jesus said in John 14:17, you know him, he lives with you and will be in you. We become the temple of the Spirit of God. He is an indwelt man. He is in the body of Christ, 1 Corinthians 12:13. He's been baptized with one spirit into the one body. He's a believer, that's why he's called brother. But now he receives the infilling of the Spirit of God, which empowers him for his service and provides the gifts for spiritual service to the Lord. So Saul is converted, he's healed, filled with the Spirit, and then he's baptized. And all of this with no apostles present. This is totally what we used to call a God thing. He was called an apostle. He didn't need others to call him into this office. God called him and placed him in that position. It says, when he received in verse 19 food, he was strengthened and spent some days, notice some days, with the disciples at Damascus. And so his one-time venom for believers is now converted to love for them, because he's spending time with these whom he would have put in prison. But now he's spending time in fellowship with them and just loving them. In 1 John 3:14, we know that we have passed from death to life because we love our brothers. Anyone who does not love remains in death. That's a good question. How do you know that you're saved? One of the ways you know is how you love the body of Christ, how you love the church. You know, when I first got saved, the day I got saved, you know, when I stood up, gave my heart to the Lord, went into the back, had a follow-up counselor talk to me. came back out to where my friends were. And you want, I'll just tell you, I've never said this. One of the things that I still remember, even as I'm talking about this, is, you know, I was a hippie, and so free love was a big thing to me. And women were not looked at as necessarily even people to me. They were there for your pleasure. That's kind of how it was for many of us. And lust was regarded as normal. Normal. And I came out from that back room, and there were these girls, these beautiful little hippie girls. And for the first time in my heart that I could remember ever, I wasn't lusting for them. I looked at them as sisters. I looked at them with purity. I have to tell you, that blew my mind. And it made an impact on me that I've never forgotten, though I don't talk about it. It's kind of personal. But that's, listen, when you love Jesus, you love those whom Jesus loves. And you can show them the love of Christ, because that's what true love is anyway, isn't it? And Paul, who had been breathing out threatenings for followers of Christ, is now hanging around with them and getting to know them and loving them. Whereas before, I looked at Christians as kind of like goofy weirdos, you know? Now I'm one of them. I'm a goofy weirdo too, you know, and I'm not ashamed of it. And not ashamed of ministering to those who still need Jesus. Just this week, I was with a young man. He actually came to the conference. I was able to see him, and he's a man who's battling homosexuality, battling it. And he's a very feminine man, very feminine. I love this young man. I've known him for many years. I love this young man. And he loves Marie, and he loves me very much. And he'll walk up to me, you know, and he's a very feminine guy. And I'll put my arm around him. I love this young man. And that's what Christianity is, isn't it? You know, that doesn't mean that I approve of the things he battles. I don't. I preach against those things because they destroy people's lives. But I love him, and he knows it. And several of us gathered around this young man, and we prayed for him. And he always gravitates to me. He'll walk up to me, and I'll put my arm around him. I love him. I'll walk with him. I feel almost like a protector for him. Why? Because that, excuse me, here we go. Because God is love. Because God changes lives. And if we can't love the unlovely, who can? And God has a way of transforming people. He does. I just say that because Paul grew to love, and that's what I want to do. Well, can we? I was going to take you to verse 31, but I'm not. I'm going to stop here because I don't want to rush. I don't want to rush through. I'm enjoying this time with you, and I don't want to rush through it. So we're going to stop here, guys. And I better make a note to myself. I didn't finish the study. I'll be told later. Let me write something. You stopped. I'm old. I'll forget. But we'll stop here. May the Lord teach us to love one another. May we learn to value the body of Christ. And though we may have hated people who were followers of Jesus, guess what? They're your family now, aren't they? They're your family. Get used to them. You're going to be in eternity with them. Get used to them here, right? Get used to them. Now, I'll close by saying this young man I just spoke of, no, I do not know that he's a believer. No, a man who continually practices sin of any sort, including that particular sin, is a man who's in bondage. No, I'm not saying that this young man's a Christian homosexual. There's no such thing. But I am saying that he is not so far away that God can't save him. And I do believe that God will use the love of Christ. And by the way, he's known me for most of his life. Most of his life. Marie and I have been part of his life for many years, many years. He knows us. He knows my children. He knows we love him. And when he went through a battle that you can't imagine, he always knew that Marie and I were very supportive in praying for him. And that, I believe, is what will bring him. That kind of love and grace and truth, that'll bring him to faith in Jesus Christ. That will. He knows the truth, but he needs to be set free. So please don't misunderstand. I am not saying that you just love the sin. No, you hate the sin, but you love the sinner. But you love the sinner. I hate the sin. It put Jesus on a cross. It destroys lives, and it ends up with eternal condemnation. I hate the sin. I have ministered for too many years to broken people, and I have grown to hate sin more and more as I've seen so many broken homes and broken children, broken lives, so much cancer, so much death, so much loss. I hate the enemy for what he has done. I hate him. I have to say that honestly, and I will battle him with the Word of God and the Spirit and the truth that Jesus Christ gave to us to set people free. I hate the sin, but I love those people that I know who are entangled because I want them free. Jesus sets sinners free, and that's what we do. We try to reach sinners. That's the bottom line. It's a bigger subject. I opened a can of worms, forgive me, because you know where I stand in so many things. But the heart must always be love for people.